Welcome back. We are going to continue on in week three with coastal processes, and we are going to talk more in detail about some of the different hazards that exist on coastlines and how we mitigate or fix those problems. So some of the hazards that exist include mass wasting or landslides, dune migration and erosion, stormy weather like hurricanes, sand supply change, tsunamis, saltwater intrusion, and changes in sea level. What you can see here in this picture is an example of a landslide that occurred on the Oregon coast near Neatharts, Oregon. And in this picture, you can see the greens where you have vegetation. You can see kind of a tannish color on that ridge line. That's where the actual landslide occurred, ripping out all of the vegetation, disrupting the soils, moving that material down slope towards the ocean, which you can see in the background with the sea stacks in the distance. And you can also see houses that are on the top of that bluff. So this can be pretty dangerous to people who want to live in these very beautiful scenic environments. A lot of locations on the Oregon, Washington, California coast have these steep cliffs that have beautiful views, and everybody wants to have a beautiful view. But some of the problems are, well, what's going to happen when the waves are eroding the bottom of that cliff, weakening the rock units? Rains come in the wintertime, add weight to the slope, and then we end up having these huge mass wasting or landslide events occurring. Some getting really, really close to these houses, and some actually taking some of these houses out. It's pretty dangerous stuff. Dune migration and erosion. Well, anywhere where we have sand on a beach, we have dunes that usually build up kind of a little bit further inland than the actual beach environment. In some places, there's dunes that are actively moving from place to place. You see this on the Oregon coast near Florence. And in some locations, we have dunes that are fairly stable. And you can see some these pictures that have dune grass growing on those piles of sand. And that dune grass helps to stabilize the dunes so they don't necessarily migrate very much. They might move a little bit with the winds, but the roots of those grasses actually help to hold the sand in place. So what happens? How do we deal with the erosion? How does erosion cause? Well, what happens is people walk on these dunes and trample the vegetation. The roots are no longer there to hold the sand in place. Winds come through and move that sand to another location, and we erode that sand away. And this can be a problem because there's lots of organisms that live in these areas, but also these dunes actually protect some of the communities further inland from the hazardous conditions on the coast. So how do we fix it? Well, education. Don't walk on the dunes. I'm telling you now. No. We also see fences that get put up to do two things: to prevent people from walking on the dunes, and also to help trap sand and keep it in place, and then revegetating areas that have lost sand. Storm surges from hurricanes are very bad, and these can actually remove lots and lots of sand from beaches. And here you can see pictures from the east coast of Florida on one of these barrier islands that is actually a barrier to storm surges, protects the mainland from these huge waves that come through during hurricanes. And in that December 2005 photograph, you can see a red line that indicates where the shoreline would have been right after that hurricane came through. Now, shoreline's not there anymore, obviously. They have pumped sand or dredged sand from offshore and put it onto the beach to build it back up to what it used to be like. And then they also planted some vegetation to restabilize the dunes that existed there before the hurricane. And then you can see the November 2009 photograph, the vegetation has filled right on in on those dunes. So what happens during these storm surges? You see that diagram in the lower right-hand corner, the white line represents the land surface, the blue line represents average sea level, and then the yellow line represents the storm surges that come through. And you can see that water actually comes up and over those barrier islands. As the water is rushing over those islands, it's slowing down, losing energy, so that the water that reaches the mainland number one, is not a huge wave, and number two, maybe not a lot of it actually gets that close. Maybe that water actually filters down into the sands and doesn't reach the other side of that barrier island. And so in this case here, what happened was the first floor of this building was actually totally filled with sand from the storm surge. So places like this, what they try to do is to have building codes that prevent people from having their main living space on that first floor. They tell them, sorry, you got to build your house on stilts. You can put your garage down there, your laundry, your storage, but it can't be bedrooms, living rooms, so on and so forth. It cannot be a main living area. That has to be above this high water mark from these storm surges. We can disrupt sediment source as well, and we do this through a variety of ways. Man-made structures such as dams actually trap sediment. It builds up in that lake that's built, that forms as a result of that dam being there. So that sediment never actually makes it out to the ocean. So we decrease the supply to beaches. Jetties do the same thing. They actually are built to keep some of these waterways open and end up forcing that sand out into deeper water, where sometimes it might make it back onto shore, but a lot of times it's lost into that deeper water. And then natural things like storm surges will erode sand and carry it either into deeper water or move it to a different beach. So you can see this example at Popham Beach in Maine, where winter storm surges came through, removed a lot of that sand, and actually eroded way back into the dunes and into the actual trees that had started to grow further inland, exposing the roots to salt water and killing a lot of those trees. This whole stretch of this beach is just littered with these huge pine trees that are no longer alive. And then you can see the Oregon coast in this other Google image here. If we disrupt the sand supply to this area, the beaches are going to erode. Longshore drift is going to pull the sand into different locations, and we're going to decrease the size of the beaches. Another hazard that exists are tsunamis. I have a couple links here that are great educational resources for you to visit. I'll post those on the course website as well. Basically what happens, you can see in this picture from NOAA in the lower right hand corner, we have some kind of a disruption on the ocean floor, such as an earthquake, a plate boundary, that forces the ocean floor up or down, and that motion actually moves the water on top of that location too, and creates this huge wave, and it propagates outwards in this kind of radial fashion, as you can see on that globe picture. And as it moves further and further inland, it actually keeps that wave height as it moves closer and closer to land, and then eventually breaks on land and inundates huge areas. So just to show you what one of these looks like, I have a little video to show you. So here we can see two plates colliding with one another. As one plate is forced below the other, we get stress built up in the rocks. The stress is released through an earthquake and forces the water above that location upwards, and then the waves radiate outwards from the center, eventually getting towards the land and filling up some of those low-lying areas with seawater. Well, I also have a video of the Sumatra tsunami that was produced by one of these subduction zone earthquakes, and here you see the orange portion of the high wave, the blue is the low, that's associated with this huge tsunami, traveling across the Indian Ocean, being disrupted and changed by some of the small islands that exist and features on the ocean floor, and traveling all the way across the Indian Ocean and actually reaching the coast of Africa. So these tsunamis can travel incredibly far distances, which is pretty scary stuff. So these websites I'll provide for you in the course website. Also, on the tsunami.noaa.gov website is a great narrated video of what happened during the Japan tsunami, which is a great resource for you to actually look at and hopefully learn some things from. Another hazard that exists is saltwater intrusion. So we have along any coastal environment, we have the fresh groundwater that comes in contact with the salt water in the ocean. The ground surface, you can see by indicated here by the land surface and the seafloor. That material has pore spaces in it for water to actually fill up and enter. And we have this kind of interface between fresh and salt water. Fresh water sits on top of the salt water because the salt water is more dense. That interface is sometimes a straight line, sometimes it's a zone that exists. But when we start building in these areas, putting in water wells, we can change where that interface is located. So here we put in a well, we start pumping water, and the more that is used, the more that's pulled out, the more that interface is changed. And you can see it's moved to where that yellow line is on this image. So the salt water actually can get pulled up into the well and then can't use it. And it also can damage a lot of the faucets and pipes and things you have in the house. Another hazard is sea level change. A lot of major cities are very close to sea level. You can see here New York City skyline, Statue of Liberty, and the Brooklyn Bridge. Very, very close to sea level, you know, within feet of the ocean surface. If sea level rose a foot or two, a lot of these places would be flooded. New York City is one example. New Orleans is another. Venice. There's whole countries in the Pacific. One example is Tuvalu. It's an island nation that is actually having major, major problems, especially at high tide when the water floods many residents' homes. And they're thinking about, well, what are we going to do when our whole nation is underwater? Where are we going to go? What's going to happen? So there's some serious questions going on. And you can Google Tuvalu and pull up some pretty interesting websites and articles about that location. So what could happen if sea level rose? I'll provide some links to these videos you guys can play around with. But basically, if we started out, you can see the picture on the right with normal sea level. If sea level rose 10 meters, you can see places around India that have been flooded, places around Europe that have been flooded. And if we go around to the Atlantic Ocean here, the red areas are places that would flood if we had 6 meters of sea level rise, mostly coastal areas, places where rivers are flowing into the ocean. So you can see a lot of our major cities that are on coastlines are going to be affected. Portland would be flooded by increased sea level, and San Francisco, New York, New Orleans, many, many major cities would be underwater. So what do we do? How do we deal with some of these hazards? Well, rezoning, making rules and regulations for where you can build new homes, where is the main living space of your house. So it has to be above that high water mark. Creating hazard maps and evacuation plans, such as tsunami plans for the coast. I'll provide you with some links to see different city evacuation plans. So if you're planning on going to the coast this summer, or in the fall or any time of year, you'll want to take a look at those hazard maps, figure out, okay, what happens when there is a tsunami? What's the warning like? What does it sound like? Where do I go? So make sure you know that information before you head out there. And you can play around with some of these locations, zoom in, zoom out, and see where we have high risk and where we have low risk. You can see in this map over here, this is from the NANUS website. Greens are little hazard outside of the tsunami zone. Yellows and oranges are in hazard areas. So some other things we can do are build some coastal structures, plant vegetation. Sometimes these coastal structures are beneficial and sometimes they're not. And we're going to play around in lab this week with some of these structures to see how they work. How are they important? How do they help people, and who might they not help? Some of these structures include groins, jetties, breakwaters, seawalls, riprap, and you guys can look a lot of those definitions up in your textbook. Book has some great figures. One picture to show here is what riprap is. I don't think your book covers that, and basically it's a pile of rocks or cement that gets piled up at the bottom of one of these steep slopes where waves are actively eroding away the bottom of that cliff to prevent that erosion and stabilize that steep slope. Revegetating and dredging are two ways to replenish areas that are in desperate need after some of these events happen. So you can see the examples from Florida where they revegetated a lot of the areas that were smothered by waves and sand so that the next hurricane that comes through doesn't create more damage. Dredging, taking the sand that was pulled offshore and bringing it back onto the beach. This is not only helpful for tourism, keeping the nice sandy beaches in Florida, but also if another hurricane comes through, it's just going to pull more sand back off of that beach. So by putting it back on much quicker, they can decrease the amount of erosion from the next nasty storm that comes through. So these are some of the hazards and ways we have tried to mitigate or fix some of the problems. So just going to kind of review a little bit of what we talked about in week three. You should be familiar now with the different types of coastlines and how they change, what is meant by a passive, active, emergent, or submergent coastline, and some of the features that are associated with each. So if you looked at the map of an area, could you tell where what type of coastline you're on based on the features that you see, what processes are happening to form those different features, and what hazards exist at each of those locations. Where do we have tsunami risk? Do we have tsunami risk on the East Coast, or do we have it on the West Coast? And some of the plans that go into mitigating some of these hazards. So we'll play around with some of these things in lab this week. So enjoy, and we will see you soon.